Hey, Sashan, what's going on? Going to talk about Traveler. Something's going on. Everyone's talking about Traveler. I don't know why. Maybe because, was it last week? Or was it 2 weeks ago? 2.5 weeks ago was May Day. Maybe that could be it. Let's hit play.
Today we're going to do something a little different for our classic tabletop RPG series. Specifically, we have to address the elephant in the room when it comes to Classic Traveler. Now, those of you who have been playing this game for
Yeah, there's the elephant. Yeah, that usually has to be brought up, especially if you're gonna have D&D players at your table. And they're interested in trying a Traveler game because you talk about Traveler all the time on your channel, so they want to be in your game, but they're D&D players and you're like, they're my friends. Should I let them in or not? Because you know how D&D players play in Traveler, right?
For the time that it's been out, or I've played it a couple times, you probably can guess what I'm about to talk about. But maybe you've heard about Traveler, but you've never played it, or you've never heard about Traveler, and you're just coming to the scene brand.
About 35% of the people out there have heard of Traveler but never played it. Maybe the rest have heard of it. The rest of the people have not heard of Traveler. And about 8% of the people have actually played Traveler in the RPG community. So yeah, the elephant's kind of a big deal. It's the wall. It's one of the walls that so-called role players have to get through or climb over or get around. It's an obstacle thing in order for them to start role playing for the first time in their lives or not.
Spanking new. As a matter of fact, this might be your first time coming to the channel. Well, before we get into all of that, let me first welcome you, dear viewer, to RPG Elite. My name is Servant of Shiloh, and this is the place where I focus on putting the RP back in the RP.
Anyway, so the reason he always says that RP puts our I have yet to see any RP from this channel. But anyway, the reason why I'm here, he says big problem and he's got a way to fix it. So I kind of know what the big problem is going to be.
PG, and the way that I do that is by giving you tools, tips, tutorials, and real talk about the tabletop RPG space and culture. Today, it's going to be a mix. It's going to be a mix about some real talk. It's going to be a mix on some tips, because of what we're going to address is it can't be considered as pure, and yet it can be considered fundamental. Let's get to this elephant and take it down one bite at a time.
The key to the perfect cookout? Ordering delivery or free pickup on the Ralphs app.
That makes sense. What separates the role players from the non-role players is what he's about to talk about. If I remember right, he's going to explain how to fix it. I don't know how he's going to fix that.
All right. So, what is it I'm talking about? It is this. And it's something that if you are going to get the game, you're interested in getting the game, and you're watching the series to see if that's the case, maybe.
Not sure what this is about. Traveler doesn't use all the dice, it only uses six-sided dice.
You've already bought the game, haven't cracked it open yet, but you're excited to do so. Okay, you need to know this. The elephant in the room is that Classic Traveler has no character progression system. So, what that means is that after you go through the character generation process, which we went through last.
Okay, I'm going to fast forward through all this because it takes him a long time to explain what that is. Oh, basically, it just means there's no leveling up in Traveler.
So back in the day, people asked, well, how can I improve my character? And the response from the developer was this. Well, It's not the character that gets better, it's the player. I mean, if you want to...
What? What? I want to know who typed that. Was that one of your comments? Sounds like a government employee for life typed that as a comment.
Going through all of that, then you might want to get with your referee and, you know, work something out with them.
Or a union member. Sounds like something a union member would say.
Is that right? Okay, that comment to me says three things. Let me...
Yeah, I've heard that comment before. So the character doesn't get better, but the player does. Spoken like a true non-believer, someone who doesn't roleplay would say something like that. Probably a Democrat. I'm just going to flat out say it's probably a Democrat. 99% of the problems in Traveler are because of Democrats at the table.
Address all three of them. Number one, if there was a list in terms of this is the reason why we didn't include this in this tabletop RPG, and it was a list of the lamest things that you could say, that would be somewhere near the top.
Is this a commercial? What is this? Is this Ant-Man crap?
All right. The whole fact of the player gets better, not the character. Listen, this is a role-playing game. And if you...
The player gets better at their craft. Maybe they commented on the wrong video. They thought they were talking about something else.
Understand the term role-playing, and you understand that you are taking on a persona. Therefore, the very issue...
So he's not a role player. He uses role playing differently than I do. I'm a role player. I'm an elite. I can't even talk. What is that? What's going on out? Anyway, I'm an elite role player. I'm in the 1%. Actually, the 0.01%. He calls himself RPG elite. Oh, whatever. That just means he plays by the rules. Rules is written. And tries to make the most out of a schlocky 80s role-playing game system. It's like, yeah, I played a role. I played a class. My class was fighter. You know, okay. That is the extent of his role-play. But when you break it down, he eventually admits to it that role-play is storytelling. Telling a story to your players. That's his idea of role-playing, and I'm against it. I'm against telling a story to my players.
You here is that you are not yourself anymore. This is not about you, and nobody is interested in you anymore. We're interested in the character.
Is he going to say in character? That's kind of important. In order to role-play, you have to be in character. I wrote a book about it. There should be a link below.
Character.
I like that. He's trying to be like a critical drinker.
Are you serious?
We're interested in seeing this character grow. The only way they're going to be able to do that is to see them go through these adventures and for them to get better at their stats, their attributes maybe, or their skills, or whatever it is. That's what role-playing is. That's a part of the role-playing. It's part of the...
And he's talking about Common Traveler, which has no backstory, no life path, nothing. It's just an index card with your stats written on an index card. And if you're lucky, you got 5 skills. That's it. I use Common Traveler for making NPCs, not for player characters.
Low-level role-playing, but it's part of it. That's a lame excuse. Lame excuse. But it also tells me this. This person may not be so concerned about the player base. I mean, this was back in the 70s. People were asking this question, and this is the response that you get? Oh, well, work it out with your referee. Really, dude?
Oh, if the comment was from the 70s, well, there wasn't role-playing going on in the 70s. That makes more sense. I thought he was saying a comment he got like last week or something.
Really? I don't know who it was specifically. I can hazard a good guess who said that. But since I don't know for sure, I won't say anything. That just, that's not a good look. It's not.
No one at Steve Jackson and no one at Game Designers Workshop. There's a few people at Mongoose, though, that can roleplay. But no one at GDW roleplayed, and nobody at GURPS, I keep saying GURPS, no one at Steve Jackson can roleplay worth a hill of beans. They just crank out books. Crank out the books. Mongoose is starting to be a crank out the books company now, too. They see the light, finally. Piecemeal splat books. Kind of unfortunate because the books are kind of meaningless. Yeah, I bought a couple about a year ago, and only one of them was worth a hill of beans, but the artwork is so bad. The artwork is so terrible in Mongoose Traveler. It's just god-awful, and I hate the new layout that they're using. The pages are so bland. It's not a what's the word when you open up a book and you look at the coffee table artwork inside and you go, wow, I want to be in that setting. What is that called? I guess evoke. The artwork for Mongoose Traveler evokes crap. It evokes the crappiest role players in the world to go on YouTube and run a game, which happened yesterday.
Not a good look at all. It speaks of a lack of concern for your player base. You just want their money. I'm just saying, that's how it looks like from this end. But it speaks to something that's even more egregious in my eyes, right?
Well, okay, a developer making money, what are they going to say? What do you want them to say? What do you want them to say 40-something years ago? Most of them are dead. Most of those guys are dead.
Maybe they had a bad day that day, and maybe they've been hearing this all along, and they just got tired of it, and they were just irritated.
You ever go to a game convention, a war game convention, trying to peddle off your RPG sort of thing? Run demo games for the worst role players ever, because there was no role playing yet, ever? Oh, yeah, you'd be burned out. And that's why the conventions tended to be near where the guys all lived. They didn't want to travel to San Diego or Los Angeles. No, they're going to stick around the Great Lakes area and have a booth at a convention of some sort. They would get burned out. You know, plus, they're dealing with all kinds of randos off the street coming into the convention. That kind of nonsense.
Whatever. Okay, I can excuse that. But I can't excuse this, especially not as an RPG elite. And that is that your statement clearly is one of an individual who is looking at this as a war game, not as a role player. Now, as a developer, you come out with a game, you stick the term role playing on it, but you expect people to play it like a war game. Now, granted, I understand all of where the movement came from for role-playing games, came out of war games. Get that. Totally get that. But if you wanted it to be a war game, should have made it as one.
Well, role-playing did not come from war gaming. It came from something else. A product that was released on bookshelves, I would say 15 years after Common Traveler had been released. Everyone knows this. This is where most role players come from. I played the game one time. So I didn't much care for the mechanic that system used. So what did I do? I just put role playing aspects into my Mongoose Traveler. Easy peasy. Both game systems, second gen. Second gen RPGs. It's easy to do. It's easy to role play in a second gen RPG. Anyway, second gen RPGs have nothing to do with war games from the 70s. Zero. I mean, you could probably connect the, you know, put thumbtacks on the cork board and run yarn, strings of yarn all along all the little thumbtacks and crap. Connect the dots. Aha! They do connect to wargaming. Well, you got a tadpole in the water, and then you have a big ol' frickin' frog. Are they connected to each other? Did one come from the other, kind of a thing? They don't even look the same. They don't even look alike. That's the difference between a war game and a role-playing game. That's the difference between a war game session and a role-play session. This guy here, this RPG elite guy, he runs his games like a war game, like a board game. He uses a board with pieces when he does his roleplay sessions, but it sounds like they're playing a war game when the players are talking to each other. I mean, just because your army of one is a thing doesn't count as a roleplaying game. It's still a war game. You just have an army of one is all. I'm a one-man army, therefore I'm role-playing. No, it doesn't work that way.
Don't put role-playing on the box and then expect people to war game, because those of us who actually...
Okay, if you look at the Traveler game that came out in the 70s, it doesn't say role-playing game on the cover. That was something, was it Kelsey or Kesley? What was it in Kelsey? The person that did Dark, was it Shadow Dark? Her hardcover book, Kickstarted thing. It's an OSR game that has modern D&D 5e terminology in it. So she put role-playing game on the cover of the book. And what's weird is in the PDF, the word role-playing does not appear anywhere. Because it's basic, you know, it's OSR. OSR is not role-playing. That's just a paraphrased text from D&D. That's all it is. Describe in your own words how you feel about your mother. Who remembers that scene?
Actually understand what role-playing is, even back then, because back then I understood what role-playing is. This isn't anything new for me in terms of role-playing. I've always done this because
he's always role-played the way people in the 70s did. This guy role-plays like he's 14 still. Okay. Get to the elephant again. That's why I started this thing. I forget that he does this. When does he start talking about Traveler again? I guess he went on a tangent. I've never seen him go on a tangent before in this video. Oh, he's got a one. Guns, guns, guns. Okay, we'll just suffer through.
Because I've always understood the definition. Now, I'm not going to get into the definition right now.
He went into the Webster's, the Oxford. He went into other things. He went into all the dictionaries until he found the definition of role play he liked. Congratulations.
I've got plenty of videos for you to go and look at. You can take a look at a couple of these. I'll have a link down in the description below, and you can take a look at them. But what this says to me...
His idea of role-playing is to use voices and to almost borderline act, and for sure as hell, tell a story. Just tell a story to your players. That's what he thinks role-playing is. You know, drama class.
this player, this individual, whoever said this, is number one, at best, a low-level role player. Number two, probably and more than likely, a tabletop RPG abuser. Again, if you don't know what I'm talking
about. Oh, man. I never called anyone an abuser. I call them just a crap-ass role player. But now I've learned in the last month and a half not to say crap-ass role player. The correct terminology is crap-ass gamer. Because they're not role-playing. They can't even play D&D. They're a crap D&D player. That's how I should have phrased it. People get upset when you call them a crap role player. And they go, Driscoll, you don't even know what you're role playing. What? I'm not even a role player. So how do you even get there? They don't even understand what a role player is. So when you say they're crap at it, they don't understand it. They're not getting it. It's not sinking in. But if you tell them directly, let me be perfectly clear here. Perfectly clear. One does not simply... You're a crap D&D player at the table in a game session. You're the absolute worst D&D player. That might get to them. Then it might register what you're saying to the person.
Talking about, got a video on that too. And that also will be down link in the description below. If that's how you want to play your games, that's how you want to play your games, but don't put role playing on the box. That's just me, y'all. So those are three problems that I find with the statement. There's more, but I'm just going to leave it at those three.
Man, he really went nuts on that one little comment. I get maybe 30 comments a day from crazy knuckleheads that have no videos on their YouTube channel. None. A lot of them are just trying to promote their own channel. And I go there and they're talking about how they're gonna start a channel and it's gonna be about Xbox gaming. Like, okay, you don't even have Xbox games on your channel? What's going on here?
So a lot of people heard that statement and was like, well, that ain't satisfactory for me. And I feel you. It's not satisfactory for me either. I just gave you three reasons why. So there's three approaches to this problem of classic traveler. Even though I am critical of the statement, it doesn't mean I'm going to tell you to go and not, you know, don't play classic traveler because of this, that. No, no. Man, I have a game in my top three favorite.
I get mad when someone says I'm role playing and I go and look and they're not role playing. That's upsetting. But if someone says they're going to play traveler, I don't care. But if they say I'm going to role play traveler, I'm like, you have my attention. You know, that's the standard Jarl Ballgroof. You have my attention. Someone saying they're going to role play in a game session. You have my attention. I mean, but if they say, oh, last night we had a game session and they want to tell me about it. And I'm like, that's interesting. I don't have their attention. If they didn't role play in their freaking game session the night before, I don't want to hear about it. Because to me, it's a complete waste of time.
Favorite games video, which I did a little while ago. I love those games. I could play those games for the rest of my life, not play another tabletop RPG.
But if they said, hey, Shauner, I role played last night. I'm like, I don't believe you. Why are you lying to me now? And I'm like, there better be role-playing in this. If I don't see role-playing in the first 5 minutes of this game session, you suck.
But listen now, I have a 30-page addendum of things that I have done for one of those games. Might be 32 now. Just think.
Why? I mean, like homebrew stuff, house rule stuff. You bought a game system that's just, it's just janky as hell. So you got to fix it to make it useful. Just throw the game away, start over, buy another game. Try again. Just buy games until you find the one that works. Find the one that works with role-playing. And then you don't have to search anymore. That's the best thing ever. Find a game system that works for role-playing. And then, yeah. That way you're not constantly buying a new game every week. Saying, is this going to be the one? Is this going to be the game? Oh, this game. And then you're house ruling every freaking game you ever buy. That's kind of redundant, right? You buy a game to play it. You don't buy a game to rewrite.
Things that I wanted to add to the game that it didn't have. And I thought that, you know, some things were just kind of not right. All right. So I went through and over time added things and hey, we're good to go. Very happy with where it's at right now. And I love that game. But that game had issues. It had problems. And of course, not having a fundamental thing like character progression and development in your mechanics. Okay, that's an issue. That is a problem. So,
yeah, games where you XP and level up, those aren't role-playing games. But yet people are fascinated so much with that. They love that mechanic. They love the dice. They love the gamey aspects of those games. They like getting, you know, they like getting treats at the end of a session. You know, Happy Meal toys. These are kids that grew up with Happy Meal toys that love the XP nonsense. So they're, I don't know. I mean, when I was a kid, they used to tease people about who watched MTV, because MTV was, they would say it's for people that don't have attention spans, because the camera would constantly, you know, flip shot, the shot would change every 3 seconds in a MTV video, so that the people watching the video would stay at attention, I guess. You know, people that have the brain of a goldfish, basically, they love XP and leveling up. They just love it. They love it to death. They love it so much that they won't frickin' start a game at level 7 or 8. They want to start a game at level 1 and just grind away, just try to work their way up, doing all the levels. I have yet to find a player who just wants to play D&D and start the game at level 10. And they have the things already. And they go into dungeons and combats and all kinds of stuff at level 10. Fighting the bigger stuff at level 10. Anyway. You would think that out of the 99.9% of D&D players out there, that one of them would do that? No, it's not in the rules, Driscoll. The rules don't say to do that.
So, there is a way to approach this and still love the game. I still love Traveler. I like Traveler as a science fiction setting. I still think it is good. It's the granddaddy, y'all, and it did a good...
I think this game's rubbish. It belongs in a museum, maybe. I don't know. I mean, it's not worth anything. There's too many prints were made of this book, so it's you'll never find the one that's worth $1 million. It's just not going to happen. The game is just it's just the bare bones. You have to house rule crap. You have to hand wave. You know, hand of God stuff. You have to do that. It mentions role playing, but just the barest minimum. Later books would mention role play, but it's too late. The Traveler players have already learned bad habits, and they're not going to change. Because it sucks. It really sucks when you're trying to run a new version of Traveler, and you got these old-ass Traveler players in your game, and they're going to play the game like the 70s, which sucks. My solution is to not invite old retards to my game table. Problem solved instantly. Instead of trying to train retards how to roleplay, start with new people who've never played these games before ever. It's so much easier. I go to game stores, do a little demo. I do the first, 20 minutes of the movie Pitch Black for the player, have them practice role playing, see how they go. There's no win lose kind of thing. It's just to show the players how the game works, how to role play. And hey, if you die, you die. If you live, that's really cool. If you live spectacularly, that's even more cool. If you die spectacularly, that's way cool. And they say, that was fun. I'm gonna try that again. And I'll bring a pre-gen character with me, so we just start the game instantly. And those people would remember the sessions. The next time they go into a game store, they're going to look for a table that plays that way. I mean, before COVID. So I don't know if those people exist anymore, because COVID really ruined the hobby. People go on YouTube and see the crazy people with pink hair, pierced noses, tattoos all over their bodies, with their they, them, those pronouns and their names. And they don't want any part of that. They don't want that. So that was during COVID when all those videos started showing up. So thank you, YouTube, for ruining the RPG community as a whole. But once in a while, they'll find my channel. And some guy will say, hey, I remember you. Some guy from the Navy. He's now in Germany somewhere. He's like, I remember you. You still playing that Traveler? I'm like, yep. I said, yeah, I got a game going over here. We're playing Traveler. And I was like, yeah. Yeah. That's cool when I hear back from somebody that they're running a Traveler game now. That's cool. Anyway, yeah, this game is shit. I always recommend Mongoose Traveler 2nd Edition. And you can play the game just with the core book. This one, it takes work. He says this is a setting. It's not a setting. It's a rule set. And by playing the rules, you're kind of playing in a default setting. It kind of is biased towards science fiction. But it's not Star Wars. It's not Star Trek. It's not Outland. It's not Alien. It's not Doctor Who, which is crap. It's not even sci-fi anyway. It's a book written in the 60s, written back in 1963, I believe. And it's called Space Viking. That's what Traveler is based on. So read that book. Read Space Viking. That is Traveler. If you don't like that kind of sci-fi, you're not going to like Traveler as written. So that's why I recommend getting Mongoose Traveler 2nd Edition. You can make your own setting for that game. It's generic enough to where you can do any setting. You can do fantasy setting with Mongoose Traveler 2nd Edition. This one, you're kind of stuck with what the book said, what the rules in the book say to do. There are fantasy versions of this book written by fans. Zozer Games has one. They're free, I think. There's a D20. No, I take that back. There's a D100 version of this game for those that like the D20 die, or the, I keep saying D20, the D100 roll, Chaosium. There's a Chaosium version of Traveler. Some people like that. There's a GURPS Traveler. Some people like GURPS. Some people like the D20 version of Traveler. It's called Traveler 20 or T. They call it T20. It's the one written by Hunter. There's the Hero Traveler. There is Empire Games, I want to say. No, Imperial Games? That was Traveler 4. Far Future does Traveler 5. There's different editions of Traveler that have different settings. So you got a Mega Traveler and Traveler the New Era going on. I like the settings. I don't like the systems those games use, but I like their settings. So I have the books just to, you know, read through the setting parts of those books.
Good job when it first came out. It's just that statement was whack, period. But let's get to, how do we approach this then? Well, it's three ways you can approach it. Three tips on how you can approach this issue of not having a character progression system in Classic Traveler, if you're still interested, and you should be, because Classic
Okay, so now we're halfway through. He's going to talk about how to fix the lack of XP or leveling up. Some would argue there is XP and leveling up in Traveler. It's just not named those things.
Traveler is still the bomb when it comes to a science fiction setting. So let's lay out these three ways that you can approach this issue.
Oh, so I use Mongoose Traveler in all kinds of settings, not just sci-fi. And if I do use it in sci-fi, it's like which sci-fi? Kind of like with fantasy. Which fantasy? There's as many sci-fi genres as there are fantasy genres. So that's why you talk to your players. Talk to your players and ask them. And you tell them what kind of game you're going to run for them, and they're going to like it.
I can't believe they recast me.
I can. He's hot.
Well, you know, at least,
three approaches.
All right, so the first way you can approach this issue is don't. Just don't even mess with it and deal with it as it is. So that's, I mean, you can approach it like that. There are many people who've been playing Traveler. There is no character progression system. So if...
Now, I've mentioned in a previous video that you're more likely to die in a game session than you are during Kerrigan. Somebody mentioned that you die in Kerrigan, which is pretty much nonsense since 1981. You're more likely to die in just a regular game session. No one ever mentions that. No one mentions Traveler character death after Kerrigan. They never talk about that.
If they mustered out at, you know, 8 years or whatever, and they're 26 years old, they just don't get any better. They might give them more rewards or something like that, or they might give them more, you know, credits in their expeditions or adventures, whatever. All right, I mean, if that's how you want to play, do your thing. To me, it doesn't make a whole lot of sense, but hey, if you guys are having fun, do your thing. So that's one way. Don't do nothing. Second way is to create your own system. Now, if you are brand spanking new to Traveler and you're brand new to tabletop RPGs, I really don't suggest doing this, especially for Traveler. There's a couple of reasons for that. Main reason for me, though, is how one level of expertise and a skill is not the same across the board. I talked about this in the last video in the series when I did character generation.
If you want to play Traveler that has leveling up in it, play Traveler 20, which is basically the D20 version of Traveler. Just play that. I mean, if you like D&D, you want to play D&D in space kind of a thing, but with Traveler characters instead of D&D characters, then play Traveler 20. You can get it on RPG Drive-Thru, I think. Or you can probably buy it from farfuture.net. I think they sell a CD of that game.
Generation with a re-up. It's not the same. So, you know, level one expertise in auto pistol is not the same as level one.
Let me check real quick. Okay, here's the slowest website I've ever seen. Is this written in what, PHP or something? What is this written in? Anyway, loading. Brrr, the server's running off an 8-inch floppy disk. Okay, so do we have Traveler 20 on here? I don't see it. Maybe he didn't get, Mark Miller doesn't have the rights to it. Right? Is the GURPS one on here? It might be on the same page as the GURPS one. Okay, here's the GURPS. These are CDs. You buy the CDs, you hope for the best that you have a computer that can read a CD, and then you save the files onto your hard drive. And then you open them up as PDFs. So there's three GURPS CDs that includes the magazines, the games, everything, maps, everything. I've got this one, Classic Traveler, and I've got the Journal of the Traveler's Aid CD-ROM. And I have the Traveler 5 CD-ROM. I don't know if that's still a thing or not. But, I don't have any of these. I might have a from Drive-Thru RPG. I think I have Twilight 2000. I don't know which one. There's like three versions of the game. I bought this one as a kid. Then I bought this one as a kid because, you know, stupid. Oh, a new one. I'm going to buy the new one. New doesn't necessarily mean better with these games. Oh, here's Hero Traveler if you have the Hero System rules. I think it's Hero 5th Edition that you need to play this Traveler Hero. The GURPS is for 3rd and 4th Edition of GURPS. And what else? Is there a Traveler 5? I thought there'd be a Traveler 5 on here. Where is it? Where are you? I'm afraid to click on some of these things. Some of these links go to porn sites. Did I do this one? Okay, what's on here? Oh, these are guides. These are brochures that tell you about the stuff you can buy from the webpage. Where's Traveler 5? Uh-oh, it downloaded something. God damn it. I didn't click on I hate this. Don't download it again, please. Role-playing games, what's on here? Okay, man, who made this website from the 80s? It needs to get updates. And then here's cancer. This site here is cancer. Oops, we ran into some problems. Just as well. Anyway, enough of that. Where were we?
Expertise in engineering, which is not the same as level one expertise in Forward Observer. So you're going to have to work that out in the mechanics. And if you're brand new to tabletop RPGs, that might be just a little bit much for you to handle. Which is why that whole thing about, well, work it out with the referee. Well, what if they're brand new? They don't even know what's up. All right, there's got to be a better
alternative. I have yet to see a referee, really. Well, I take that back. There's probably like four referees for Traveler that can even run Traveler. Four on planet Earth. Out of all of them, only four know how to run the game.
alternative, and there is. And this is kind of the route that many people took when that response was given. So let's take a look at the third approach. Now, there were different versions of Classic Traveler, and we're starting with the starter set, right? The starter set is actually books 1, 2, and 3 of Traveler. The third.
Yeah, he keeps showing the wrong box. This is not Starter Traveler. Starter Traveler was the starter set for Traveler. People that didn't know anything about anything, they would get the starter set. The starter set does not have drugs in it. Drugs were removed from the rules. I don't remember why.
Books 1, 2, and 3.
This is one of the originals. I don't know if this is the first edition, or I don't know if this is first printing or second printing of Common Traveler. But you notice it doesn't say anything about role playing on the box. Four reasons.
3 of Traveler. The third approach actually comes in book 4. That's called Mercenary. This particular supplement for Classic Traveler, and it is specifically for Classic Traveler, is if you want to be a mercenary, it's got new skills and other things like that.
Yeah, it's for a lot of people like this book because they're war gamers and they don't plan on role playing. They just want to shoot and kill all the things and they want all the cool weapons. That's what this book is for.
It also has a skill training section. And here is what you can use just right out the box, if that's how you want to use it, is what you can.
There's like 2 different rules for this. You can spend a few weeks time studying, and then you make a roll, and if you succeed, you gain a skill point. But it has to be something you've already know. It can't be like a new subject to be training in. It has to be a skill you already have that you want to increase. And then something about your intelligence and your education, add them together, something like that. There's a kind of like a cap on how much you can improve your character. It depends on how much intelligence and education your character has, I think. I don't use this rule because I only do one shots. I would not use Traveler to do a campaign. Traveler is not the right game for doing a campaign with. You know, Traveler is for doing a one shot film, you know, Star Wars, Minority Report, Logan's Run, an episode of Space 1999. One shot, you know, a 4-hour long one shot, complete story. And then you make new characters for the next one shot. That's how you do it. I mean, if you're going to do a boring ass campaign like The Expanse, what are you doing? What are you doing besides playing Candyland? What are you doing in your game group?
Use just right out the box if that's how you want to use it, or you can tweak it. Now I'm going to give you a couple of ways to tweak it here in a second, but let me give you the cliff notes on how this works. So you would go find an instructor. The instructor has to have the instructor skill and also has to have the skill.
Oh God, you're not going to just say what I just did, are you? Because he takes forever to explain anything. Let's skip over. What is this, a commercial? It is. I don't monetize my channel, so yeah, hopefully I don't have that nonsense in my video. Putting the RP back into RPG.
So the first thing that I would do.
There's the one lie. And that is, I'm a role player. I've been role playing for 30 plus years. That's the big lie. Now, when you say you're going to put RP back in RPG, what does that mean exactly? Because I have not seen it yet. I have not seen it yet. If he writes a book about how to roleplay, I might read it. I mean, I have a feeling he's going to write a book because his videos are episodic, like chapters and sections in a book that he's got a script for that he reads from. So I'm sure he's going to have a book or a blog. He's going to pull off the, what is that guy's name? Sly. Oh, my battery. It's dead on my flashlight. Sly, what's it called? Sly Furish, Return of the Lazy Dungeon Master. The book is just reprints of a blog. It's just reprints of pages from a blog. I mean, that's fine, I guess. Instead of reading, you know, 2 or 3 years worth of blog posts, just buy the hardcover book. But they're blog posts. The articles in the book are blog posts. Dear Diary. A blog is your... I have a blog. It's Dear Diary. That's what blogs are. Dear Diary. Today was an interesting day. I'm going to type about it. I would never put my articles in a book. That would be retarded. It wouldn't even look right. Some people do. But yeah, I would like to read his book when he ever writes it. I'm not going to read it if it's online. I'm not going to read it if I have to be a Patreon or a Kickstarter or whatever. Just put a fucking book on DriveThru. I'll read it. I'll review it. See if it's remotely playable or understandable. Or if it's just the same stuff that Professor DM says, DM Lair, Matt Colville, Goy, Seth Skorkowski, everyone but Matt Mercer. Everyone but Matt Mercer. Matt Mercer is the only one who knows what he's talking about. His style of role play, he can explain how he does it. Everyone else on YouTube who's doing the D&D nonsense, they can't explain anything out of a paper. They can't explain themselves out of a paper bag to save their life. It's all, let me work with the YouTube algorithm until you've seen at least 7 minutes of my video. And then I'll say, make sure you hit that like and subscribe button and notify, hit that notification bell. All that nonsense. It's a huge-ass scam. It's a huge-ass pyramid scheme because you're thinking, oh, I'm going to make a YouTube channel too. I'm going to make money on my YouTube channel. But you have all these charlatans above you doing it already. And unless you're on their show, no one's going to know about you. And even if they do know about you, you're going to have all their weirdo audience on your channel. Who wants that?
Is to make sure that the characters have to pay. Because in the mercenary system, that's if they're training to be one. So they go through that to get their level one of something. But they're out of the service now. So now if they're out of the service, they're in the private sector. You got to pay a brother.
Yeah, some of the referees just hand out guns, ammo, powered armored suits like it's candy. Here you go. You guys have that. Oh, you guys, you guys have those. You all start out with that stuff. Okay. What is going on? You probably won't die in the game when the referee is giving you all that kind of stuff. And so the players go into audience mode where they just sit at the table and they don't participate in the game. They're just the players, if they do role play, they are role playing a studio audience. Doing what the viewers at home are doing. Just sitting there, enjoying what the referee says their characters are doing and making moves for the players because the players just... They just want to roll dice. They're just there to roll dice.
Ah, show me the money.
Pay me. Mm-hmm. make sure they have to come out of pocket for this stuff, which means that this is just motivation for them to go on more, you know, adventures or expeditions or missions, whatever. So they can pay to become better at the skills that they...
That's unfortunate. Then you're using Traveler to play Counter-Strike or Call of Duty, Gears of War. I would love if someone got this far in my video, I would love for somebody to do an actual play of Dead Space using Traveler rules. That would be the best thing ever. And it has to be role played. Don't be playing it like Call of Duty crap.
They have, or just to acquire new skills. Another thing that you may want to do is you may want to make the pay reflect the level of the skill of the instructor. So if it's just a level 2 instructor.
I'm not a fan. I'm not a fan of walking around in Skyrim, walking up to some rando person like, hey, oh, teach me how to do one-handed combat. Here, let me show you a few things. And you get like 2 levels increase of one-handed weaponry. I hate that. I hate that in Skyrim. I hate leveling up in Skyrim. I just want to stay the same. But no, it forces you to level up. Now, you don't have to choose a perk. Now, the perks, you can let those just build up. You can use a console command and erase the perks, so you're not constantly reminded, hey, you got some perk points to spend. Just get rid of them. Just delete them. There's little scripts you run that just delete your perk points. So you never have... you never do the perk tree. That's an idea. I should probably just upload that to Nexus Mods. Here's a bat file that deletes your any perk points waiting, you know, sitting out there. I should do that. That'll give me something to do this weekend.
Instructor who wants to get you to level 1, then it might not. Maybe it's just 10,000, right? But if it's trying to get you to level 2, maybe it's 20. Level 3 is 30. So on and so forth, that it goes up and up and up and up.
Okay. It's no difference than the magic shop in D&D. Let's go to the magic shop and just buy all the magical stuff that we would have found if we had gone into the dungeon. Just go to the store and buy the stuff. If you want it, if you want that sword, just go buy it.
The more that you want to go up and up and up and up. Then there is findings that instructor. Maybe the lower instructors, there are probably a lot of them. The higher tier instructors, yeah.
I already know how that's going to be role played. The player is going to say, is there someone here that I can learn from? I need to increase my gun combat skill. And then the referee says, yeah, there's Sam. Here's Sam. He's right over here. Did you want to ask him something about that? And then the player says, how much would it cost to go from gun combat 3 to gun combat 4? And then the referee's like, let me check here. That'll be 30,000 credits. You know, that is how 99.9% of Traveler players play their fucking games.
They're going to be rare. And so I would take a page from the psionic section when you have to actually search for the Institute. And I would say, okay, if it's a population of 9+ or something, you'll probably get a DM of +1 to try to find somebody that's an expert at that.
Yeah. But the player says, I want my character to be psychic, and he's going to go look for the psionic institutes on each of these planets. And he's going to be, every time he goes to another planet during the game, he's going to automatically look for one of those. Sort of like an autopilot, auto macro playing in the background during the game. That's his turn automatically whenever they step foot off of a ship. And then, you know, maybe 3 planets later, hey, there is a, without the player saying a word, the referee just says, hey, what do you know? There's a psionic institute where you guys landed. shoot me, please. If I'm in, just hand me a gun. I'll put it in my mouth. If I'm in a game session with those guys.
But it still would be hard, you know, give it a relatively hard, like 9+, 8+, something like that, to actually find these instructors in these areas. Maybe you have to do a whole trip, and the trip itself is an adventure just to go and get your skill up. Now, obviously, these skills are going to take time. And as it says in the mercenary system, it takes 6 weeks to get up to level 1. So the next thing I would do is, you guessed it, I would increase the time for every level that they want to increase their skill. So
just like in Skyrim, unless you mod it, if you mod Skyrim, then you pay the same amount of money each time you level up. Because it's linear. The improvement would be linear. One-to-one kind of a thing. But if it's a tangent kind of thing going, or not, maybe it's not called a tangent. What would that be called? You know, like X equals Y squared. You know, one of those kind of things, right? Or Y squared equals X? Anyway, who knows? One of those kind of... He had the chart earlier on the screen. So like, let's say it's $100 to learn a skill. But if you want to learn that skill some more, it's now $1,000. If you want to learn that skill some more, it's now $10,000. And then $100,000. You know, to learn this, you know what I mean? That's how Skyrim is.
Well, level 1 would be that 6 weeks. For level 2, and I'm just going off the top of the mind right now, it would be 12 weeks. Let's just double it. And level 3, 18 weeks. So on and so forth.
Now in my game, in Skyrim, you learn it instantly. If you have the money, you just learn it instantly. There's no, like, weeks have gone by. There's no montage. But in my game, in my Skyrim, I think you'll find a trainer and he'll say, this is what's happening to me in my game now, because I'm at level 50 almost. All the NPCs I run into now say, you already know all that I know. And I was like, oh man, now I am the master. You know, that kind of, my character's saying that to people now.
So obviously all of this stuff is happening offline. This is happening off camera. This is not happening during an adventure. So increase the time.
Yeah, people do that in Jump. During Jump, it takes a week to go to another planet. The referee will say, any of you guys going to do any training during this week? You can do training if you want. Because that's, you know, it's a game show host always has to say what the contestants can do on the stage, right? If you guys want to buy a vow, you can do that now, or... if you want to do a lifeline or do 50-50, you can do that as well. It's up to you. Yeah, just shoot me if I'm in someone's game and the players are all leveling up during a jump. I'm trying to think, in what sci-fi movie where they freeze themselves or whatever, when they go into jump space, or let's say one of the players stays out of the Freezer Rio during the jump, spends a week outdoors. How about, is there a movie where a character had done that? And at the end of the week, the character's all buff. He's been working out. He knows Kung Fu now. He knows 2 different alien languages. He knows martial arts. I said to Mark Miller, you got to do something. This was like 20 years ago. You got to do something. Because GURPS was ridiculous. GURPS Traveler was absolute ridiculous. I think I said to him, end the license, please. End it. I was like, they have a 20-year license. Oh, 20 years. I'm doing the math in my head. Okay, 98. 20 years will be 18. 2018, the GURPS license will expire. Oh, yes, there is a God. But I suggested to somebody over there back in the day, what was that? Oh, it was the Usenet. It was on Usenet, remember? Usenet. It was, there was a traveler thing there. MIT nerds were involved. And I said something, nah, it was on the tip of my brain. Hey, let me see if I can remember. Oh man, I can't remember now what it was. Anyway, it was a real fix. What he said here will remind me.
So obviously all of this stuff is happening offline. This is happening off camera. This is not happening during an adventure.
Yeah, I can't remember now. But I remember mentioned it to the GURPS guys. Who was that joker there? Lauren Weissman. He kicked me from the forum, so I was banned. I'm banned from Steve Jackson Games. Then I mentioned it to the other chuckleheads over at the Citizens of the Imperium forums. And somebody there, after I was being banished from that place, someone there saw what I posted and they contacted me in an email. And they said they're working on that. And they worked on it and they fixed it. So there's, and I can't remember what it is now, but there is a fix. There was a fix put in later editions of Traveler that fixed this nonsense about training, leveling up during jump time or vacation time, whatever, the players fast forward, you know, a month or two in advance, and all of a sudden everyone's leveled up and ready for the next quest. Oh, there's a fix for that. That was on the tip of my brain too. I'm still thinking about two videos I need to make after this one, and I'm thinking about the comments down below I've been seeing from my last three videos. So I have to like look at those. I need to focus on what I'm doing here. Know what I mean?
So increase the time, increase the money, and then have some kind of search mechanic. The higher up that you go, the lower you go, it should be pretty common.
Okay, so he's house ruling Traveler, which is, I don't do that. I remember when Mongoose Traveler was being playtested, I noticed there was no Government 5. Like, how come Government 5 is a blank? It's just an empty box. So when you read what it says for Government number 5 in the Mongoose Traveler book, for second edition, I wrote that. In the Word document, I just typed that in. What was it? Matt was all, just type in what you think it should be. What sounds best in life? I did. I basically put in there what Space Viking talked about a lot for Government 5.
These are just suggestions. You can go ahead and tweak it however you so desire. But I would use that mercenary system kind of as a base, tweak it for however you want to do it, and then go about your business. So there it is. We've tackled the elephant in the room. And again, even though they don't have something that's fundamental.
Okay, so he tackled this problem with more rules. Next time, fix the problem through roleplay. Roleplay solves everything. I've said this for 15 years now. Roleplay solves everything. Nope, we need more rules. I just need to control my players more with more rules.